So welcome to this session coming to you from Delft in the Netherlands. This is a session for the Virtual PowerShell Conference Europe 2020. We are going to talk about Azure DevOps today and specifically how you can use it for all your PowerShell needs. My name is Barbara Forbes, and before we get into this, I want to consider the awesome sponsors that have made PSConf EU possible. So as I said, my name is Barbara Forbes and I'm an IT consultant working at SCCT in the Netherlands. I'm a Microsoft Azure MVP as well as a Microsoft Certified Trainer, and I have a blog on Azure and Automation running at Forbes with a 4.nl, and my Twitter and GitHub handle are BA4BES. I will show this slide somewhere in the end if you want to reach out. And this is Azure DevOps. This is what a project looks like if you visit it in the web interface. But more than that, this is our agenda for today. We will go through a bunch of these features you see in the menu on the left. First, we will do a quick overview. What is Azure DevOps and why will it make you happy? After that, we will look at the boards to help you with planning your development. We will touch on using repositories as a Git provider. And after that, we'll spend a big amount of time on pipelines, as I think there are a great amount of use for them in your PowerShell scripts and modules. In the end, we will consider artifacts as a way to create your very own personal PowerShell gallery. First things first, what is Azure DevOps? In its core, Azure DevOps is tooling to help you with your DevOps work process. DevOps isn't easy to explain in one sentence, and I'm going to reference a definition that Microsoft uses. It was created by Donovan Brown. DevOps is the union of people, process, and products to enable continuous delivery of value to our end users. This is a great definition of what DevOps is, and there is one thing that I want to emphasize: the delivery of value. It's not about software, and it's not about a specific module or a specific language. It's about value. And this means that DevOps might be helpful for your workflow, whatever you are working on now. And even better than that, you do not have to use a DevOps workflow or work with a team for that matter. You can just take a look at the tools, see what options you have, and make it work for you. You can create your own DevOps environment by going into dev.azure.com. And as you can see here, you can get started for free. You can actually go quite a long way before you have to pay anything or you have to enter your credit card information. There are a lot of options to play around and see what is of use for you. You can create your organization with a personal Microsoft account, a work or school account, or with your GitHub account. When you use a work or a school account to create an organization, it will be connected to your Azure AD. You do not need permissions to do that or even a license. And for the Azure administrators that are now thinking that is not something I want, you are able to turn it off. But by default, everyone can create their own organization. Bottom line, it's a very simple process to start playing around. And one thing that I think is important to mention is that although it's called Azure DevOps, it does not have to be connected to Azure in any way. You can use it combined with GitHub, with an on-premise environment, or as a standalone tool. It does have some nice options to connect to your Azure tenant, but it's not needed if you have another use case for it. Let's look into the boards. The boards are a planning tool that you can use to keep track of your work items. Like in GitHub, where you have issues, in Azure DevOps you have the boards. But the boards are a lot bigger than that. Boards are based on an agile workflow. Now, agile is a lot more than just how you plan your stuff. And I'm not going to go into too much on what agile is, because I don't think I would be the best person for it. And the way I use the boards myself and in teams that I have worked with is kind of like a to-do list, but then a really, really extensive one. And there are a couple of options available, and one of my favorite things to use is the Kanban boards. And a Kanban board can help you visualize all the things you have to do. And this Kanban board is the most basic version that is available. It's actually called the basic board. And it separates all your items that you need to be doing into to-do, doing, and done. And the items that you see, you can drag them around these boards. And this can help you keep track if you have a lot of stuff to do, to prioritize. And to if you're working in a team, you can see who is working on what and get a really quick overview. And one of my favorite things about this is that it challenges you to see what items are relevant now and what things can wait for later. And even if they can't wait, they are gonna wait by saying, in this time period, I'm only focusing on these things and I will not look further than that after they are done. So this can help organize your mind a bit. Now, as I said, this is the most simple version that is available. And I want to show a quick example of one of my personal boards. And as you can see, you can do a lot with these columns. You can make your own columns in there. You can tag all your work items, have some color coding going on. You can color the items themselves if it works for you. So there's a lot of flexibility there to start working with it. And this board is from some time ago when I had a lot of talks going on, a lot of blog posts. I was running some PowerShell modules that needed to be maintained. So I had so much stuff going on, basically for my personal things, that I created this board to keep track of what I should be doing and what I could get into. So this can really help keep yourself sane. And if you think this is interesting, I really like working with this as a team as well. And one of the other use cases I find really nice is if I have written some scripting or a module, this is where I keep all my issues and I can easily distinguish between bugs or features and make clear to all my colleagues at what things I am working on at this point. And another thing that I think is really important, if I drag them to resolved, I can say, look, these are all the things that I have done. It really helps if you're doing small improvements that people might not notice, but it also helps yourself to say, check, I did it, it's done, off my list. The repos. Azure DevOps can be used as a Git provider. You might be familiar with GitHub, GitLab, Bitbucket, or tooling like that. They all do the same thing. They help you with a Git working process. Now, I'm going to make the assumption here that most people who are watching this talk might already be familiar with Git. If you are not, or if you know what it is but you haven't been able to get into it, really try to invest to get started with using Git, because it can help you so much with keeping track of your work process. I have some blog posts on Git for the absolute beginner focused on PowerShell, and I will link my blog again in the end of this talk. For now, I'm not going to focus too much on what Git is, but what Azure DevOps can do for your Git process. You can use it like any other Git provider. So you can store your scripts in the repositories. And it doesn't work that different than anything else. What I do want to show is what it looks like on the Azure DevOps site. And I can talk about it, but it's more fun to show you how it actually works. So I've created a project called PSConf.eu. As you can see, this is a private project. I can create private projects or public projects. Public means it is publicly shared. Now, here if I create the repositories, I do have a nice little party trick here. And that's the button clone in VS Code next to all the other options. But let's see what this one does. Now, this wants to open Visual Studio Code, which makes sense. And it asks me to open an extension, allow that extension to open the URL. And it opens the file explorer and I create where I want the repository to be cloned. And now I have a cloned version. Regularly, this would ask you to sign in somewhere in between, but I am already signed in to my Azure DevOps organization. And ironically, I get a pop-up from GitHub saying I need to sign in that if I want to use it. Anyway, I create a README file because every repository needs one, and I call it repository, and I can push this to Azure DevOps the same way that I would do any other GitHub providers. And Azure DevOps has the same options as some of the providers. There are branch policies available. I can say I do not want to be able to push to master. I can do pull requests and the complete process that works with that. So a lot of options there, and I think it's mostly a personal preference whether you use Azure DevOps or GitHub or GitLab or whatever for your Git. And as you see here, my README is now in the web browser available. Before we move on to the pipelines, there is another option that I want to show you when you are working with Azure Runbooks. You can set up a sync between your Azure DevOps repository and an Azure Automation account. Now let's see how that works. Here I have prepared a repository with two folders in them, one development folder and a production folder. And there are just some example runbooks in here with an Hello World output. And here I have an automation account to show as an example. Here are the runbooks that are put in there by default as an example. And if we scroll down a bit, here we have source control. So if I click source control and choose add, I can give it a name. And I can select that it is an Azure sync. Just a quick heads up, if you like GitHub, also you can set up a source control with GitHub. But we're talking Azure DevOps here. So this asks me to authenticate, and it can actually do that against a different account in a different Azure DevOps tenant than the Azure tenant I'm working in. So I click accept here, and it's authorizing for me. So I can select a repository. So this was the one I was just working in, and I'll select that repository. I can select which branch I want to choose, and of course this one only has a master branch. I think it would be best always to choose the master branch for that, but you do have the option to have a separate branch that is synced with production. And I can select a path for a folder that will be synced. Now in this case it would sync every script in my repository, but I'm gonna say production, as I just created that folder, and have that sync. Now I select auto sync here to automatically sync the runbooks as soon as I make a change in my repository, and I let them automatically be published. So let's save that. And here it is saved. And what I can do is click it here and say start the sync. So it will create that initial sync job. And I can keep track of those by clicking sync jobs here. And the first one, of course, will be a full sync. And you can keep track of everything that is happening in the meanwhile right here. And what it will basically do is look at the scripts that are in that production folder here and sync them with the runbook environment. And it is running now. Now, one of the best things of this is that I have some quality control on the Azure DevOps site. I know these scripts are always the right scripts. So although I do have source control without having a pipeline here, I can of course create a pipeline for my scripts just to test them and to run pastor testing and stuff like that and have it both ways. And as you see here, it has found my runbook called example runbook. Let's see if it has finished by now. And it said it's completed. And I can look over here at the runbooks. And example runbook is here and it is published. So this can be a really nice option if you are using Azure DevOps at this point. Now we got our scripting in that repository, and now we want to create a pipeline. What is a CI/CD pipeline? Basically, it's a bunch of tasks that you run. And often you would do those manually if you have updated a running script. If your script is ready, maybe you would run some pastor tests and you would copy it to your live environment. Or if it's resources, you would deploy it to Azure or to your scripting server. And the pipelines can do that for you. You can have them automatically be triggered by any commit to your repository. And this means that you save a lot of time because it's all been done automatically and you get a very consistent environment where always the same tests are run and the same process is followed to push it all to production. A pipeline runs on an agent and Azure DevOps can provide you some agents with different OSs. They can provide agents for macOS, for Windows, Windows Server, Windows 10, Linux. So there are a bunch of agents available with some software installed on them. And an agent is a virtual machine or a container where all the scripts run. This also means that you could have your own agent. You can just install an agent on a virtual machine yourself and have that one be have exactly all the software and specs that you need. Now, this is a pipeline of example of a pipeline, and this is a pipeline for an Azure Function app. And in this case, it's a multi-staged pipeline. In Azure DevOps, you have the option to create a pipeline visually, so you can click through the browser interface and create your pipeline like that. Or you have a code pipeline, which is built on YAML. And they have been pushing forwards to the YAML approach, which of course, it helps because your code is stored with your code. So your pipeline is stored with your code and it makes reproduction a lot easier. And in this example, you see the first thing I do in this pipeline is create a test and a build where I build the function app, which basically means that all my script files are put together in a zip file. And after that, a deployment to, in this case, an ARM template with the function app. And after that, it deploys that code to my function app. These are all standard tasks within Azure DevOps, so I do not need to do anything for them, which is pretty nice. Now, I want to show you how you can get started with creating your own pipeline. And to do that, I have created a module in our PSConf EU repository. This is the module PSConf EU demo, and it consists of basically some files where you can get sessions or get speakers from PSConf EU. This is nothing more than a wrapper around an InfoGrest method, which you see here, which was not created by me at all. It was created by the team. And I can get a session, get sessions by tag, get speakers. This is really a basic module to just have an example. I have a module file out there, a manifest. And I have created some pester testing to have something to work with. So I have a pretty complete module. And now I'd like to create a pipeline for that. So I go to pipelines and click create pipeline here. And as you can see, I can get to choose between a lot of providers. I do not have to have an Azure DevOps repository. I could host this on GitHub and still use the repositories, the pipelines in Azure DevOps. And actually, if you connect it with GitHub, you can still even say that it has to be triggered by each commit. The direction is two-way. I do not have experience with all the other providers that you just saw, the Bitbucket and other providers. So I'm not sure how good that works, but it is nice to have that option. But I had just created everything in the Azure repository, so I will just use that. And I select the project I'm working with and the repository I'm working with. And it asks me if I want to use an existing YAML file or if I want to create a starter pipeline. So if I had created a YAML file beforehand, because I had created them before more than once, I could use just use that file. But for now, we're gonna create a new file. So I select starter pipeline and it creates a bit of a pipeline for me. As I said, this is all in YAML. There is some good documentation on what every aspect does and what the syntax is. In my opinion, the hardest thing, especially if you come from PowerShell, is that indentation matters. So you have to have your spaces in the right place. That takes some getting used to. But other than that, this is pretty intuitive. The basic pipeline that it creates has a trigger to run with every commit to master, and it uses an Ubuntu image that is available in the pool provided by Microsoft, and then it runs two scripts, and they are both Hello World scripts. And I can run this. So let's say I say save and run here. And it creates that pipeline. And this is the pipeline that immediately starts working. It is queued at this point. I have noticed stuff is getting a bit slower. And you see the warning at the top that says that it's all a bit slower. Because the capacity is a bit low. But here we have it already running. And I can see it has run the scripts, the Hello World scripts, and every task came back positively, like it worked, which makes sense because there hasn't been done anything. It just output Hello World. So there's no way this pipeline could have failed. Now, if I move back to the repository, there will be a new file created there. And it is called azurepipelines.yaml, and this is where my pipeline now is. So it's stored in my repository with the rest of my code. And as you see, this is the same stuff that we talked about before. And I can edit it here, but I can also move back to the pipelines and edit it from here. I can also do this if this is stored in GitHub without an issue, and it will update it there. And what I get here, what I think is pretty nice, is the agent. And here I can see all the tasks that are by default available for me. And if I run PowerShell, you see I have Azure PowerShell, where I have an Azure module and connection set up. I can use regular PowerShell, PowerShell on target machines. So a lot of options are available to run some PowerShell scripts. And if I use that, here I can select that I want to run a file, or I can select inline. And now at the left, I'm gonna put the cursor at the right place and click add, and it creates that YAML for me. So if you're getting started with YAML, this is really an easy way to get into it. And you can get back to that menu. As you see, there's a settings button at the left. So I can change it up there and add it again. Now the options you get here are very basic, but this can help you get started and see how you can follow along on your way. You saw all those tasks that are available. There are also tasks in the marketplace. If you haven't found one that fits your need, there are some community driven tasks out there that are pretty good that you can use in your pipeline as well. Now let's see if we can use that pipeline to actually deploy something. And the first thing you might think about is deploying stuff to Azure, which is really useful for. But it's not your only option. You can also deploy to an on-premises environment. And you can do that by installing an agent on a local server. And all the scripts that you run, all the tasks, will be run on that local agent. And there's a copy file task which you can take the files in your repository and copy them to your scripting server. But I'm going to look at another option, which is deployment to the PowerShell gallery, because I have just created a module and I want to see if I can publish it to the gallery. And to do that, I have created a pipeline file that does exactly what I'm asking for you. And I will make this all available for you. And this is deployed to gallery with a trigger on commit to the master branch. And the first thing it does is perform pester testing with a pester task from the marketplace. And after that, it will deploy to the gallery, as you see here, with just a simple PowerShell task and publish module and use of an API key. Now let's save this pipeline. And it will run immediately because it just did a commit to master. And let's see. Here we see it started running. I will admit here for a second, as this whole session is recorded, this demo is recorded as well, and I cheated with the time because it was taking a long time. So I sped it up just a little bit, as I do not feel like staring at the counting clock. Now, as you see, the first thing the pipeline is doing is pester testing, and it's our two stages. And if the tests fail, the deployment will not happen. If the tests do not run, the deployment will not happen. So this can really help me with consistency in my repository and in the gallery or in my production environment, wherever that may be. So the environment has been started and it's actually finished now, the tests. And in the left corner, I have an extra tab here and I can see the results of the tests. And I can see how many tests have run, because imagine something is wrong in your script and no tests were run at all. It will still come back as a positive result. But here it says 5 tests have run and 5 tests have passed, and I can see what has happened with them. So that's pretty cool to have a bit of an overview. And because everything was successful, I now have a deployment, and this is all updating real time. And I can see at what stages is and what is going on. And it's now running that PowerShell one-liner to publish my module to the PowerShell gallery. And it's done. And I have no output because I didn't create anything. I could have done that, but I didn't, because it was just for this. And now let's see in the gallery if it had actually deployed my module, as I hope. And I look at my published packages here. And there is the module we just created. So it's got the right name and it's the packages here. And this is version 0.0.1 and it's deployed a few seconds ago. So everything worked. And now I should be able to install my module directly on my PowerShell prompt. And it starts installing. And just like that, completely automatically, I have set up a module in the PowerShell gallery. And I can use the same functionality if I would want to push an update to the module. And here we see it working with all the sessions that were planned for the original PowerShell Conf EU. This also means that the demo would be a lot cooler if the conference had actually continued in real life. Oh well, let's hope they use the same technology next year and we can make use of it then. So that was the deployment to the PowerShell gallery. And now let's see how we can create our own gallery using the artifacts. In the Azure DevOps artifacts, you can create a NuGet feed. And in that feed, you can store modules so you can have a repository like you would have, like the PowerShell gallery is. And I want to show you how that works. And I created a pipeline and I have used the pipeline we have used before, but now I have changed the deployment part to deploy to the feed that I have created in the artifacts. So the first part's all the same, and after that it's going to deploy to the feed. And to do that, you need to create a new spec package. And I do have it in the feed here by using Chocolaty to install the NuGet CLI. And Chocolaty is a default installed on the Windows agents that are provided. I'm not sure if this is the best way to do it. You might want to create that file manually to have a bit more control over it. But I had to see if it could be done. It can be done. And it creates a package and pushes this to the feed. And if I look at settings, it looks like I had to create an ID. But I can just select this from a drop-down menu and it will create that ID for me. So that's pretty nice. Makes it easier for me. Now, I have run this pipeline before. And it has deployed my PSConf EU demo package to my feed. And here I see that feed and I see the package in this case. And as you can see, this is a lot like the PowerShell gallery. I can see who has created it. I can see how many times it has been downloaded. I can create tags for it, so it should look pretty familiar. Now I need to connect to that feed to be able to download the packages. And here I have set up the command list to do that. And I use the URL and give it a name. And if I run this, I have set up the organization name already. So let's run this. And what it does is ask me to create a device login. So this is the same way you would connect to the AZ module to your Azure tenant. So let's click here. And I select the account which I want to connect to Azure DevOps. And now it takes some time and it will create that repository for me on my local machine. So I can see now if I use getps repository that I now have two repositories here, the gallery and my own repository. So if I use find module on my own repository, I get PSConf EU demo, like I just created. And I could install it from there if I wanted to. And this is gonna fail because I have already installed it from the official gallery in the last demo. but it will work that way. So this is pretty cool stuff, but it does need to come with a bit of a disclaimer. It's not working perfectly yet. It's not completely smooth. And the biggest reason for that is that you struggle with the credentials. And in the past, you would have to pass your credentials with every interaction with that gallery, which also meant that if you just used update module to update all your modules or find module, it would not look at the gallery, but first ask you if you for credentials for the gallery you just created. So that can be a bit tricky, but there is a lot of development going on now with the new version of PowerShell Get, which is currently in preview. And I think some stuff is already happening because before I needed to create a credential object and now I get to do a device login. I'm not sure if it's related to that, but I do feel this might get better in the future and make this a great option to use. So I do want to show what your options are and what you can do with this. So with that, I think we have reached the end of what I wanted to show you as some stuff where I think Azure DevOps is a great tooling for all your PowerShell scripts. If you want to read more about PowerShell or Azure DevOps or other Azure automation, you can find my blog forbeswitha4.nl. And if you have any questions, reach out on Twitter at BA4BES, which is also my handle on GitHub and GitLab. And the most important thing is saved for the last slide, which is the next PowerShell Conference 2021, which will hopefully just be in person so we all get to see each other again. Again in Hanover, Germany on the 1st to the 4th of June. So you can sign up starting at November 2020. And that is it for me. I want to thank you for all your attention and hope you enjoy all the other sessions that have been made available.